This is NBC 5 Chicago, your Olympic station.
Today's Olympic coverage on NBC 5 Chicago is brought to you locally in part by Jewel Osco, by Commonwealth Edison, by Chili's Grill and Bar, by Infinity, and by Circuit City.
Olympic Stadium, site of course of track and field, 85 degrees as of about a half hour ago, 56% humidity at Olympic Stadium. Ahead tonight, Carl Lewis and Michael Johnson, but first,
Aborigine to win an Olympic medal. Aborigines were the original inhabitants of Australia, and when early settlers arrived, they destroyed their homes, killed their families.
Batter dip shrimp and five bold new Southwest Fiesta shrimp. 10 shrimp fries and hush puppies, just $2.99.
Gotta get a little old John Seven with sun shrimp. 2 days with the only one John. Gotta get a little old John right now.
This is NBC 5 Chicago, your Olympic station.
Today's Olympic coverage on NBC 5 Chicago is brought to you locally in part by Jewel Osco, by Commonwealth Edison, by Chili's Grill and Bar, by Infinity, and by Circuit City.
Olympic Stadium, site of course of track and field, 85 degrees as of about a half hour ago, 56% humidity at Olympic Stadium. Ahead tonight, Carl Lewis and Michael Johnson. But first, the women's 400 meters. Let's get right to it as we join Tom Hammond.
All right, thank you, Bob Costas. It is a very pleasant evening here at Olympic Stadium and jam-packed, over 80,000 fans on hand as we do come up to the women's 400 meter event. One of the favorites here is Kathy Freeman of Australia, competing in Atlanta for all the usual reasons, but carrying additional incentives, the memory of a sister, Anne Marie, who died of cerebral palsy, and the hopes of her people as she attempts to become the first known Australian Aborigine to win an Olympic medal.
Aborigines were the original inhabitants of Australia, and when early settlers arrived, they destroyed their homes, killed their families, and took their freedom away.
Basically, they tried to get rid of my race, totally. And so today, a lot of Aboriginals suffer from low self-esteem and feel that they can't achieve in this world.
Catherine Freeman has broken away from the sad legacy of despair and disillusionment that has plagued her people. It was the 1994 Commonwealth Games, and after victories in the 400 and 200 meters, she proudly carried the Aboriginal flag. This simple act became mired in controversy.
Basically, what it all caused was like a reopening of an old wound. A lot of Australians didn't sit too comfortably with this black girl carrying around an Aboriginal flag. But it's funny because 70% of Australia thought it was quite terrific. They thought it was a very positive positive thing.
To her, it wasn't anything to do with politics. She did it because a lot of the kids back home look up to her and see her as an inspiration.
Everybody else tells me, oh, you just don't know what you've done for your people. You just have no idea. But, I mean, I have not only affected children, but I've affected the elder people of, you know, of the community, the ones who never thought that there would be someone like me out there achieving what I have done.
Freeman, we understand, should she win the gold medal tonight, she has a special flag, Aboriginal on one side, Australian on the other. Joined now by Carol Lewis and Craig Masbach. A tough assignment for Kathy Freeman, though, because of the presence of the defending Olympic champion.
Marie-José Parek, and I talked to Nick Bedeau, Kathy Freeman's boyfriend and manager. I said, how are you going to beat Marie-José Parek, the defending champion? He said they think they planted a seed of doubt in Parek's head by some of the fast early races. They hope Parek will go out quickly and crumble in the home stretch.
Here are the lane assignments. In lane one, Britt Breuer of Germany, coming off a drug ban that ended late last year, but in that very tough lane one. Lane two, Pauline Davis of the Bahamas, silver medalist at the World Championships last year, coached by Gwen Torrance's husband, Manly Water, lives in Atlanta, went to Alabama. In lane three is the defending Olympic champion, Marie-José Parek, a real celebrity in France. She fled and lives in Malibu, California now. Lane four is Kathy Freeman of Australia, right? Second in the world last year, but a disappointing fourth at the World Championships. In lane five, Fale Ogunkoya of Nigeria, an All-American at Mississippi State University. In lane six is Fatima Yosef of Nigeria, a 25-year-old who also has U.S. ties. She was the 1994 NAIA champion while attending Azusa Pacific. And in lane seven will be Sandy Richards of Jamaica, 27-year-old, a two-time Southwest Conference champion at the University of Texas. She was seventh in Barcelona. And in lane eight, the lone American hope, Gerald Miles of Gainesville, Florida, and Alabama A&M, second at the U.S. Trials, the 93 world champion. She won the bronze at last year's Worlds in Sweden.
Well, Tom, in this race, it's an outstanding field. There are five women under 50 seconds this year being led by Marie-José Parek. Gerald Miles has dropped under 50 seconds this year. She has run 49.96 this year for a year's best. Lane eight should be okay for her, but I look for Parek is in a good position. She has a look at every other athlete in the race that I think can give her trouble. Freeman has learned about going out too fast last year at the World Championships. Yusuf and Ogunkoya from Nigeria love to go out fast.
Fatima Yosef of Nigeria is running well. Now Parek begins to pick up the pace, and Kathy Freeman too.
As I said, Parek in lane three in the blue with a bare midriff. She is in a great position. She has everyone in her sight.
Sandy Richards of Jamaica, Fatima Yosef of Nigeria. Here comes Kathy Freeman and Marie-José Parek. They're at the top of the home straightaway. Parek has the lead. Freeman in second, moving alongside the challenge. It's Parek and Freeman strive for stride, and Parek, the gazelle, has the advantage. Marie-José Parek back-to-back for France.
48.26, an outstanding time, Carol.
Incredible time, and I'll tell you, Marie-José Parek has so much pressure on her. An Olympic record. You know, she moved to Malibu, California to get away from the French press. She is very hard on her, on them, and they are very hard on her. I'll tell you, if she didn't win this race, they would have crucified her in the newspaper.
Her coach, John Smith, coached the 88 Olympic champion on the men's side, the 92 Olympic champion on the men's side, and now moves to the women's side of things for another 400-meter champion. And Parek didn't do what Kathy Freeman hoped he would do, go out too quickly and crumble in the home stretch. now will decide whether she wants to try to match Michael Johnson by doubling back and trying to win the 200 meters.
Well, you know, I said she was in a great position because she was in lane three. She had Freeman, she had Ogunkoya, she also had Yusuf on her outside. Yusuf has been going out very, very fast. You see her third from the left of the screen, but Parekh and Freeman, they were the only ones who mattered on the home stretch. For a few seconds there, it looked like Kathy Freeman, you see her gritting her teeth, trying to catch up to Parekh, but Parekh just upped the game just a little bit more and comes home with the win.
Parekh is just so strong in the home stretch when she measures out her effort early on, and her only real weakness was a mental weakness, all the pressure put on by the French press. John Smith is just a master at working with athletes on believing in themselves and getting the most out of their training. By living, as you say, in Los Angeles, she avoided the scrutiny of the press, was able to be just an athlete, an unknown athlete in the Los Angeles area.
During the U.S. trials here at the Olympic Stadium, she was commentating for French television. Chris Collinsworth had and I had a chance to chat with her. Very charming. Sometimes has a reputation as being temperamental, but was doing a good job on French television and charmed Chris and Tom that evening here at the Olympic Stadium. So the French tricolor flies over the women's 400-meter event. Marie-José Parekh defends her Olympic championship. Back-to-back goals. Kathy Freeman of Australia, the silver. And the bronze medal goes to Ogunkoya of Nigeria.
To ignore Olympic history, because no American has ever won the events in which you now compete. No golds ever in the balance beam or the floor exercise. You have to ignore recent history, because you seem to have lost your edge. Now you must try to find the proficiency of Barcelona. For you, one more chance to make history. You could become the first to win your event four times, and just the fourth to ever win nine career golds. For you too, history beckons. Today, a victory in the 400 is assumed. Next, the 200, the dare for the unprecedented pair. For you, history is encouraging. 18 times, Americans have competed in springboard. 15 times, Americans have won. Two more, try tonight at the Centennial Olympic Games.
Honey, we've got nothing to worry about.
The nest is empty. See, man, forget cable. I told you. It's only on DirecTV.
With DirecTV, parents can control over 175 channels of entertainment. Even when they're not there.
Technology stinks.
For the choice of movies, cable, and sports packages you can't get anywhere else, it's got to be DirecTV.
NBC's coverage of the Centennial Olympic Games is brought to you by Northwestern Mutual Life. Have you heard from the quiet company? And by Saturn, a different kind of company, a different kind of car.
Welcome back to Studio One at the International Broadcast Center. Hi again, I'm Bob Costas. Day 11 of these Centennial Olympic Games. More track ahead, of course. Also diving, men's springboard. After the semifinals, the favorite, Dmitry Sauton of Russia, is tied for second with American Mark Lenzi, who is the defending Olympic champion. The other American in the event, Scott Doni, is hanging in there too. He's fourth. Gymnastics continues with the second night of event finals. Vitaly Sherba of Belarus is among the big names competing in the men's events. On the women's side, Americans Dominique Moceanu and Shannon Miller are involved. But just after 7:30 Eastern time tonight, only a few minutes ago, it was announced that Kerry Strug is out, and she will be replaced in the floor exercise by Dominique Dawes. Overall, as you know, the American women have struggled since winning the team gold last Tuesday. One other note before we head back out to the track, Centennial Olympic Park will reopen tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. A brief ceremony will take place to mark the occasion, and NBC Sports will cover it live. The men's 110-meter hurdles is next. The United States has a very impressive Olympic record in this event in 21 appearances, 17 gold medals. And coming into the Atlanta Games, the two top-ranked high hurdlers in the world were, in fact, Americans. Also in the mix, though, world record holder Colin Jackson of Great Britain. So let's go back out to Olympic Stadium and rejoin Tom Hammond.
Sunbathed Olympic Stadium in Atlanta, another jammed house to see the stars of track and field competing on the fourth day. And already we have seen one of those stars in action here this evening, Gail Devers, winner of the 100 meters, and now taking the track in the quarterfinals of the women's 100-meter hurdles. As of now, she stands in the same position she did in Barcelona, having won the 100 and trying to take gold in the hurdles. And running in lane four, she quickly establishes control of this race. Now remember, in Barcelona, she was in the same position as this in the final when she hit the final hurdle, fell, and scrambled across the finish line in fifth place. But here, Craig Masbach, no problem, continuing on to win this heat.
A good adjustment from the sprints to the hurdles, Tom, but she's going to face a very tough opponent in Sweden's Ludmila Enquist, who in her round ran the fastest time in the world this year, 12.48.
So Gail Devers moves on to the 100 hurdle semifinals on Wednesday. Now we move to the men's 110-meter hurdles semifinal round. And in this semifinal round, we have the world champion representing the United States, Alan Johnson from Chapel Hill, North Carolina, and the University of North Carolina.
Alan Johnson has switched to the black sunglasses from the red, white, and blue. No lack of patriotism on his part, but he says, I'm a meaner looking and feeling guy with those black sunglasses on.
He's been trying to sort of refurbish and jazz up his image because he's very shy. People say he's colorless, so come up with a change of sunglasses. I'm not sure if that'll do it, but a gold medal probably would. Let's take a look at the lane assignments here. In lane one, George Boroi of Romania, oldest in this semifinal heat. He's 32. Li Tong of China, lane two, two-time NCAA champion. He was at Washington State. Lane three, Sven Pieters of Belgium, the Belgian national record holder. In lane four, Emilio Valle of Cuba, sixth at the Olympic Games in Barcelona. In lane five is Alan Johnson, half of the Johnson & Johnson story here at the stadium tonight. Lane six is Colin Jackson of Great Britain, actually from Cardiff, Wales. World record holder, he's looked good, winning two preliminary races yesterday. Lane seven is Kyle Vanderkuyp of Australia, the Australian national record holder, first Aboriginal to set an Australian record. And in lane eight, Christoph Melik of Poland ran 13:51 in his quarterfinal. And we have nine. Eric Kaiser of Germany was advanced to this round after Britain's Tony Jarrett tripped over a hurdle, causing Kaiser to fall as well. So nine hurdlers in this semifinal.
Well, we talked about the black sunglasses and the mean visage of Alan Johnson, but he told us something very interesting. He says it's like a bottle of soda that you shake it up. It looks innocent, but when you take off the top, it explodes. He says he has to get angry before races in order to be highly motivated.
And Alan Johnson and Colin Jackson are away together with Emilio Valle of Cuba. Those three leading as they come down through the lane, and now Alan Johnson takes command. Jackson is there, Valle is there as well. Johnson eases up and wins in 13.11. I think Van der Kuip of Australia got the fourth and final qualifying spot behind Johnson, Jackson, and Valle.
Plenty of personality in that sort of time in a semifinal run. And he faced a very tough challenger in Colin Jackson, the man on the left of the screen, Johnson in the middle. When you have someone right alongside you like that, it challenges you to get out of your race plan and establish the race plan of the person alongside of you. He didn't do that. He maintained his composure. And after the sixth hurdle, took control of the race, and with each additional hurdle, pulled away. And so easy off the last hurdle to the finish line, in spite of that, a very fast time, 13.11.
Let's get an idea of just how fast they were. You hear them hitting the hurdles as they go over.
Well, they say in the hurdles, if you try to run fast, you lose, because you have to make so many quick adjustments as that hurdle comes up to face you. Tremendous dexterity required to negotiate these hurdles at top speed. In the entire hurdles race, there are only 2 seconds of hurdling. The rest of it is an all-out sprint.
Coming up in the next semifinal, Mark Crear of the United States. A study in courage. We'll explain why when we return to Atlanta's Olympic Stadium.
Tomorrow and today, Atlanta Centennial Park will reopen with a special memorial service. Only the Today Show will be there as it happens tomorrow.
When fewer than a hundredth of a second, inches, or even half a pound stand between you and a medal, what can make the difference? What makes a champion? The latest secret weapon. Watch NBC Nightly News tomorrow.
A promise to solve problems, expose what is wrong, help you make it right. Commitments made. NBC 5 News. Relentless investigation. Action. Results. Commitments kept. NBC 5 News. To protect your family. To save you money. Target 5 reports. To give you plugs. Commitments you'd expect from NBC 5 News. Committed to Chicago. There's only one athlete in the world good enough to wear this. And there's only one small car good enough to wear this. Ford Escort, a runaway bestseller for 14 straight years. No small car is safer in a frontal impact or delivers more features for your money with almost $2,000 in savings. If being number one is good enough for you, there's only one choice, Ford Escort. See your favorite Ford dealer today. Home to 5 of America's top 10 bestsellers. There's more to a Ford.
Assume there is a limit to how far a human being can leap.
Olympic Stadium. Here are the results of the first semifinal in the men's 110 meter hurdles. Alan Johnson of the United States, 13.10. Colin Jackson, Valle, and Van der Kuip also qualifying for the final, which is later tonight. Now ready for the second semifinal, featuring Mark Crear of the United States a young man who has to be hurdling in pain, hurdling with a broken arm.
Ran into his coach, Tony Campbell, yesterday. He told me that he's been keeping this a secret, but on July 16th, only 13 days ago, he fell while doing a workout drill, broke his arm. Doctors strongly recommended a cast. He said, no, it would throw my balance off in the race. It would also give hope to the other athletes. He's been icing it, taking anti-inflammatory drugs. He won't even wear a soft cast away from the track. Says he just has to tough out the pain of the broken arm.
Just moments ago, we saw Mark in his pre-race ritual as he removed the sunglasses, crossed himself, and kissed the hurdle.
Importantly, that was the first hurdle, which he sometimes hit and had troubles with in races.
Assignments in lane one, Igor Kazanovs of Latvia, 32 years old, a semifinalist in Barcelona. In lane two, Vincent Clarico of France, another relative graybeard. He is 30 years old. Mark Creer is in lane three. He was in the delivery room. His wife, Keisha Marvin, gave birth to their daughter, Ebony, on July 14th. Lane four, another American, Eugene Swift. A big surprise, he's a supervisor with UPS in Richmond, California. The company allowed him time off to train for the trials, and he is featured in some TV ads playing on our Olympic coverage. Lane five, Robert Foster of Jamaica, the current Jamaican national champion, went to Fresno State University. In lane six is Florian Schwarthoff of Germany. If he looks tall, he is probably the tallest world-class hurdler ever. 6'7", he was fifth in Barcelona. In lane seven, Johan Elisabeth of Belgium ran 13.53 in his quarterfinal. And on the outside in lane eight is Eric Bate of Cuba, who was seventh last year at the World Championships in Sweden.
Mark Creer ran very, very well in his earlier races. You have to wonder the sort of pain he feels. You see him shaking out that left arm on the right of our screen. Wonder about the pain he feels. Tony Campbell says he feels it at all moments of the day. Tony Campbell, a three-time Olympian, obviously helpful in getting Mark Creer to try to look past this broken arm. But this is sometimes a contact event. Sometimes you hit athletes in the lanes on either side of you.
Eugene Swift got a good start. Creer was a little tardy out of the starting box, but now he's making it up. Creer and Swift, and just inside them, Clarico of France. Here comes Schwarthoff. Florian Schwarthoff takes the lead. Swift and then Creer. The two Americans will qualify, but 6'7", Florian Schwarthoff, the winner. Mark Creer did not get a good start.
And there's no question that it was bothering him during the race. You could see that left arm as he runs, not getting the sort of full range of motion that you wanted to have. He'd been working on his arms all year. This is the irony of that, because it's the action of the arms that helps get the legs back down on the track, helps you get back into a sprinter's running position as opposed to a hurdler's position over the hurdles.
Schwarthoff the winner, with Swift and Creer there, and Eric Bate of Cuba also moving on to the final later tonight.
There are the two Americans. Eugene Swift ran a very, very good race. But take a look at that left arm. It's just not the usual action that you'd expect to see with it. And you can see the extra look of concentration on his face. You have to think every time he lands, there's a little extra pain that comes because of the broken arm. Now, he did run well, as I said, in the earlier rounds, and it could be that you're correct, that it was just the slow start that put him behind, and all he looked for was a safe qualifying opportunity.
Well, maybe we can find out, because Mark is with Chris Collinsworth.
All right, Tom, thanks. Mark, is that arm impacting you at all? Does it hurt you going over the hurdles?
Well, it doesn't bother me going over the hurdles. You know, I thank God that I made it to the finals, and I'll put it out on the line, and my arm won't be an excuse. No reason why I won't win that gold.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Tom.
All right, Chris, so the key qualifiers in the men's 110-meter hurdles. The finalists here will be in action later tonight. All three Americans, Alan Johnson, Mark Creer, Eugene Swift, plus Colin Jackson, Florian Schwarthoff. And you see the entire eight-man field that will contest the final later tonight. We're set for a real big night here at track and field. It's a royal night at Olympic Stadium. King Carl, Carl Lewis, in his final leap across the Olympic stage. the man who would be king, Michael Johnson, racing towards history. Tonight, he reaches for gold.
At the Principal Financial Group, you'll find the strength of our investment performance is your 401k retirement advantage. You'll find our flexibility will meet your insurance needs. And you'll find the balance of choice and quality you need in health coverage. For over a century, you've trusted the Principal for strength, flexibility, and balance in retirement, insurance, and financial products. At the Principal, we give you an edge.
Looks like you've been grinding a bit, Michael.
It's kind of weird.
That's great.
All right. I don't like it.
You know, at the Olympics, IBM has technologies from 10 different companies working together. They might be able to help you. Good. Now rinse.
Thanks, Harry.
It all started when my niece and nephew sent me a Saturn brochure. See, I live in a pretty small town. Doesn't even have a stoplight, much less a car dealership. But when I saw what the Saturn had to offer, I called the closest retailer, even though it was all the way down in Salt Lake. No problem, they said, we'll pick you up. I guess I assumed that they would come in a car. But Scott, the Saturn sales guy, was also a pilot, which was fine with me. And 250 miles later, we were there, and I finally got to see a Saturn. I bought the gold one. Good thing, I guess, considering that no one had ever mentioned how I was going to get home.
NBC this fall. It's the first must-see TV family comedy.
Bill just walked in on me again. You have any idea how that feels?
No, what's that like?
Where a new marriage puts two families under one roof.
You're not allowed to see my daughter naked.
Yes, sir.
Always knock.
Yes, sir.
You can call me Dad.
Think of it as a must-see guide to parenting.
Nicole, get in here!
It's not Nicole's fault.
I know, but now that I've used that tone of voice, I have to blame her for something.
Something so right. Tuesdays this fall on NBC.
Welcome back to Olympic Stadium, where later tonight we'll see Michael Johnson in the 400-meter final. But next up, the long jump. By itself, one of track and field's most popular events, but tonight's Olympic long jump taking on added significance. The stage is set, the curtain ready to be drawn. 80,000 pairs of eyes are focused on this box of sand. Mike Powell is the world record holder, colorful and flamboyant. The new character in this drama is a product of the Cuban sports system. Ivan Pedroso, the world champion, 23 and ready to call this event his own. But both men forever in the shadow of this man, Carl Lewis. Tonight, in his final Olympic appearance, his legacy is secure. But last night, it looked like his tale would end one day too soon. His Olympic career down to one jump. Carl Lewis stood at the end of the runway and refused to say goodbye. Would it be Carl Lewis to go out with a gold medal? Now for a report on the beginning of the long jump competition, let's go to Dwight Stones.
All right, Tom, this is an ex-athlete turned broadcaster's dream, the chance to call the last Olympic appearance of a legend in track and field. Oh my goodness, and he runs right through the pit,
He's had so much trouble getting his steps right on this runway throughout the qualifying round at the trials final, and even yesterday in the qualifying round. So that will be a foul for Carl Lewis, and he had said so many times the key to this competition is to get a big one early. Now, here's a guy we haven't heard from all year long because he severely hurt his hamstring back in March, had it surgically repaired, has jumped only once in competition in Spain earlier this month. And he is jogging down the runway by comparison to 1995 when he jumped 11 times over 28 feet and actually had a world record negated because of altitude and wind, actually just because of wind up in Sestriere, Italy, a foul for Pedroso. And now comes Mike Powell, who has got a great draw in this final. He's after Lewis and Pedroso. He is the world record holder. He is twice the world champion. And this competition is his for the taking. He wants it badly. He checks up a little bit at the board, but at least it gets a legal mark. The key to Powell's year this year is that he's back with his old coach, Randy Huntington, the man who coached him to the 1991 World Championship and to that world record, the one that he beat Bob Beamon's record by after 22 years. He's tentative on the runway, though. His speed does not look good, and his trajectory is way too low. He needs more height off the board, and you see him drifting off there a bit. That's a patented long jump landing by Mike Powell, but that is not great technique, and it's a very poor distance. 25, 10 and 3 quarters, but at least he's on the board. Now, Joe Green. It's the same American setup as it was 4 years ago in Barcelona when they went 1-2-3. Joe Green is actually in probably one of the best positions. He's 11th in the order for the first three jumps, and he usually gets a big one early. And Joe Green looking right down at the board. You can never do that. You can never look at the board when you are going down the runway. You've got to trust that it's going to be there. So Joe Green just sort of dumps out on that one. So early in the competition after the first round, Emmanuel Bang of France is leading with Glavatsky of Belarus second, and the Americans are only fifth and seventh. Carl does not have a mark. Let's go back to Tom for the men's 800 semifinal.
This heat featuring the lone American hope in the 800, 36-year-old Johnny Gray, who has qualified for his fourth U.S. Olympic team. He is the American record holder, has run the 8 fastest times ever run by an American. He won the bronze medal in Barcelona.
7th in 84, 5th in 88, 3rd in 92. There's only one place for him to go, which is number one, and that's the sort of numerology he's engaging in.
Here are the lane assignments.
Atungamana from Burundi was second in last year's World Championships. Definitely someone to watch. And Curtis Robb from Great Britain. How about this, Tom? When Curtis Robb was 19 years old, his father went into a London bookie and said, I want to put some money down on my son winning the 1996 Olympics. That was 5 years ago. He put down $300 at 500-1 odds. This man could win his father $150,000. Got to win the Olympics, though.
Center of your screen is Johnny Gray, 36 years old.
He's had a remarkable 20-year partnership with his high school coach at Crenshaw High in L.A., Merle McGee.
They'll run in lanes until the top of the back stretch and then break out of that, and Johnny Gray is taking it out early. Now, an unusual situation. There are 3 semifinals, so only the top 2 from this heat and the next 2 fastest overall will advance to the finals. And Johnny Gray is in front. In second is Fred Onyancha of Kenya. Now Jose Luis Barbosa in the blue comes up to take over second place.
That qualifying situation suggests that Johnny Gray and the others will want to run as fast a race as they can to have a day of rest before the final on Wednesday. They really should just blow it out, because if they do, maybe 4 from this heat could qualify.
Johnny Gray continues to set the pace with Barbosa in second. Johan Bafa of South Africa now being passed by Fred Onyancha of Kenya as they have less than a lap to run, and Johnny Gray continues to lead.
Johnny Gray runs best when he's in the lead, when he's not in traffic and that long stride's not being impeded. And he runs well when he runs a good third 200, which he's doing right here. He says he likes to take people into the Johnny Gray twilight zone.
Johnny Gray leading Fred Onyancha of Kenya. Atungamana
is also from Burundi, trying to pick up the pace, and Lalu of Morocco.
Lalu, very dangerous, the man in third, a former 400-meter runner who's shown great development in the 800.
Johnny Gray is still in front. Oyanja of Kenya, Lalu of Morocco, and Hutungimana of Burundi. Johnny Gray is still there. Oyanja up on the outside. Lalu making a challenge as well. Only the top two have qualified. Tight to the line. Gray, Oyanja, and Lalu.
Very, very tough to see who the top two were at that finish line. The good news is the time, 1:43.99, one of the fastest ever run in a semifinal race. Johnny seemed to be looking around a little bit as they came up to the line.
He may have been third.
Very, very close.
It appears that Lalu of Morocco, I think, was the winner, the man on the extreme outside.
I think Johnny Gray did get it on a lean, but we'll have to wait for the photo.
Maybe he did lean for second. It was tough to tell. He was on the extreme inside.
Seems very motivated by this crowd.
Lalu of Morocco was indeed the winner, and Gray was second. Gray was second, so he gets that automatic qualifying spot by the slimmest of margins. A tight finish, and just a lean there at the finish got Johnny Gray automatically in. He is the lone American in Wednesday's final in the men's 800-meter run. Don't forget now, Curtis Robb of Great Britain, his dad, well, will not collect that $150,000. His son did not make the final. Coming up, the touching story of Cuba's Ana Quiroz.
And Tom, we will in fact get to that in a moment, but a word on Johnny Gray, the only American finalist. As Tom just pointed out, this could have been his fifth Olympic team, but actually at the Olympic trials for the Moscow Games, which we wound up boycotting anyway, he didn't qualify, but he actually has been involved in Olympic competition dating back that far to 1980. This is his fourth Olympic team, and he's gotten progressively better. He was seventh in his event in Los Angeles. He was fifth in Seoul. He was third for the bronze medal in Barcelona. He's into the final here in Atlanta. When we come back, more from Olympic Stadium, of course, the women's 800-meter finals, as Tom Hammond promised, including the compelling story of Cuba's Ana Quiroz, the Barcelona bronze medalist. After those games, she was badly burned when the kerosene cooker in her kitchen exploded. There were seven skin graft operations, but now, amazingly, she has mounted a comeback. The women's 800 meters is next after this.
Imagine a world where you could do anything and leave old, inefficient ways of doing business behind. Georgia. With new ways to find and share information, AT&T can streamline the way you do business, so there's no limit to what you can do.
You think?
Oh no, ice.
What the Bravada thinks?
Decrease coefficient of friction, divert torque to adjust wheel velocities.
With its exclusive smart track system, the Bravada automatically reacts to changing road conditions. So with no buttons to push or levers to pull, you can let it do the thinking.
Oh no, marbles.
Looking to quench your thirst? Squeeze a juicy lime into an ice-cold O'Doul's. It's outrageously refreshing.
Hey!
I hate it when he does that.
They're among the most sought-after prizes on Earth, the Olympic medals. Revered by athletes, Olympic and armchair alike. So you'd imagine that for UPS, who brought every gold, silver, and bronze to Atlanta, it was no ordinary delivery. But maybe it's because we don't believe there is any such thing as an ordinary delivery that we were trusted with this one to begin with.
To some, people are either Brazilian or Norwegian, Indian or Chinese, South African or Dutch. To us, it's much simpler than that. People are just small, medium, or large. Haynes, proud to sponsor the U.S. Olympic team from head to toe.
NBC's coverage of the Centennial Olympic Games is brought to you by Coca-Cola. Reach for the refreshing taste of Coca-Cola Classic. Always for the fans, always Coca-Cola.
Welcome back to Olympic Stadium, where you're looking at Ana Quirot of Cuba. You may have a favorite in this race, someone you're rooting for, but save a small spot in your heart for this woman of extraordinary courage and iron will. She's been an Olympic favorite. She might win tonight. But that she's running at all is a miracle.
In my mind, I created an image that nothing had happened to me. I forgot everything. I cannot give you any details. I do not have any memories. I think it was something horrible.
There was a before in this tale of before and after, a glorious, dazzling before. Ana Quirot was a runner and a model and a hero. The world's best at 800 meters, a bronze medalist in Barcelona. In a nation of sports idols, she was the most famous of them all. If her triumphs were Cuba's, so too was her tragedy. So poor, so beset by shortages, Cubans washed their clothes on kerosene stoves, using alcohol instead of soap. It happened only 3 years ago, and all Quirot remembers is the flame leaping out at her.
When a person experiences such difficult, dramatic moments, sometimes you prefer not to remember anything, as if nothing happened.
Third-degree burns covered 40% of her body. 7 months pregnant, she gave birth, only to have her baby die 10 days later. Doctors questioned if she would live. They told Fidel Castro, who rushed to her side.
They didn't let anyone into the burn unit, but they let him in. I told him I would run again.
But he saw what she couldn't see. He just smiled and said nothing. For 3 months, she lay in the hospital. She jogged for the first time a month later, a little over a mile in a little under 9 minutes. And 9 months after nearly burning to death, she fulfilled her promise to Fidel. Unable to tilt her head, her arms constricted by scar tissue, in her first race back, she finished second.
It was truly impressive, one of the most impressive things we have ever seen in our lives. She has won a silver medal for the competition and a gold medal for her courage.
The struggle has been as much mental as physical. Her comeback as a woman as inspiring as her return as an athlete.
I try not to look in the mirror, but why should I always be looking in the mirror? I am the same, simple, joyful, elegant. I haven't changed at all.
Last summer, Ana Quirot returned to the World Championships, and for reasons that defy rational and medical explanation, she won.
It was amazing, even for me. But at the same time, it wasn't so amazing, because I know how strong my will is.
Whatever your politics, you have to admire this woman. And after all, isn't putting politics aside what the Olympics are supposed to be about?
You know, Cuban officials didn't even want to let her go to the World Championships because they were afraid she would embarrass herself. She came home with a gold medal.
But a tough task for her in this 800-meter final because of the presence of that woman.
One thing that helped Anna Caro to that gold medal is the fact that this woman, who has not lost a 800-meter race since 1992, just after the Olympics, Maria Mottola, was disqualified in a semifinal race for stepping on a lane line. Certainly would have been a big challenge for Caro to beat her in that World Championships.
Here are the lane assignments in the 800 final, with Mutola beginning in lane 5 and Kirot in lane 6.
Masterkova from Russia looked very, very good in the semifinal round.
Back to Anna Kirot for a moment. You know, she is named for Fidel Castro. Her middle name is Fidelia.
She watched ESPN while rehabbing and doing exercises to try to break up scar tissue, and follows American sports via satellite.
And the starters' orders are to stand up.
Very, very noisy in the stadium. Some of the athletes in the sprints have told us they have trouble sometimes concentrating, hearing the commands even of the starter.
Maria Mutola from Mozambique traveled over 10,000 miles away from her home, not speaking any English, to go to Springfield, Oregon, the Eugene area, where she developed into a world-class runner.
Tommy, athletes have to stay in lanes around this first turn. It was on this first turn that Mutola stepped on a lane line in Gothenburg at the World Championship, so you can imagine she's being very careful about that right now.
And there they do break out of their lanes, with Svetlana Masterkova, the woman that you mentioned, has been looking very good, representing Russia, moving out to take the early lead. Mutola is there with Kirot just on her outside.
Masterkova has the fastest 1,500-meter time in the world this year. Expect to see her in that event also.
So it's Masterkova, Mutola, Kirot, and here comes from Russia also, Afanasyeva.
I wonder if the Russians are running a little bit of a team race here, wanting to keep the pace moving, but also wanting to perhaps box in Maria Mottola in the red on the inside right now.
Masterkova and Afanasyeva of Russia are running together with a lap to go, then Mottola and Kirot.
Actually, the pace right around 58 seconds, somewhat modest. Not as fast as we've seen in some recent major championships. And Mottola told me the only thing she feared in this race was a fast early pace. She didn't get that. She's also in a terrible position right now, as it's Kirot who's making a move on the backstretch.
Kirot comes to second. And Kelly Holmes of Great Britain now third, and Mutola's kicking it in as well.
Holmes has been sidelined by a tendon injury. They think it might be a stress fracture. Incredible courage that she's even in this race. And Mottola better start moving if she's going to have a chance.
Masterkova and Kelly Holmes are together. Then Anna Kirot and then Maria Mutola. They hit the home stretch. Masterkova still has the lead. Kelly Holmes is there. Anna Kirot and Maria Mutola. And Masterkova kicks it into gear. Kirot takes over second. But it'll be wire to wire. Svetlana Masterkova of Russia. Kirot and Mutola with Holmes in fourth.
That looked like a very planned race, something that you might have seen from the old Soviet Union. In the old days, the Soviet athletes would team up. Think of what the best strategy was on a team basis, with one athlete perhaps sacrificing him or herself for the good of their country.
And Anna Kirot and Maria Mutola, two of the favorites, getting medals. But they will be silver and bronze, because Svetlana Masterkova, 28 years old, had the fastest time in the world this year at 1,500 meters and may run in that event later. And she's still running.
She's doing more than just a victory jog. This is a victory sprint.
But hats off to that lady, Anna Kirot. What a courageous performance. Silver medal at the Olympics. Maybe she can finally smile.
She was poised, ready to go for the victory in the home stretch, and Mastrikova just had an incredible stretch run.
The gold to Mastrikova, Kirote the silver, Mutola the bronze.
And that is a wonderful story with Anna Kirote, the bronze in Barcelona. She comes up with the silver here. Yesterday, Javier Sotomayor, who is the world record holder, as you probably know, in the high jump, did not make it to the medals. He bombed out early. It's safe to say that Sotomayor and Kirote are among active Cuban athletes, the two biggest sporting heroes in their small nation, and Kirote has all of Cuba smiling tonight. Later on, you'll be seeing gymnastics, the individual event finals, and with a preview, here's John Tesh.
Event finals in gymnastics coming up a bit later from the Georgia Dome, the first piece of business for you. A little while ago, American Carrie Strug entered the arena to formally answer the question that everyone is asking. Can she, will she compete this evening? Has her ankle healed enough since the gold medal team performance? And the answer, well, it was brought by Bella Caroli, her coach. So, on the last night of gymnastics, Strug had to, in fact, withdraw. And afterwards, she spoke with our Beth Bouillet.
We had to come down to a decision. I wanted to wait, you know, to the last minute, try and give it everything I got, you know. I was going to put up a fight, and, you know, we just realized everyone thought it was in my best interest, you know, not to go out there tonight. I could, you know, do a lot more damage, and, you know, even though I, you know, my heart really, you know, tells me you can do it, but, you know, I think reality, you know, I realized when I tried to do some more things that, you know, it wasn't really possible. So, you know, we had to come down to this decision.
So the final decision for Carrie Strug, coming up a bit later on, event finals, the last night of gymnastics at the Georgia Dome.
Now let me get this straight. What you're saying is all those Delta Sky miles I'm accumulating on this marathon
will never expire.
Just fly with us once every 3 years.
So 10 years from now,
you're still good.
Half a century past.
Still good.
Oh, I'm 104 and I need a vacation.
Have you flown with us once every 3 years?
Absolutely.
Hawaii's nice.
Are you colder than I am? How is that?
Wait, wait on.
It's a hot melt in here.
Heads up, look out.
Wait a minute, wait a minute. Can you see anything yet?
Just a second. Settle down. He's opening the refrigerator.
Oh, me, it's not a store brand. I can't see through you.
But you move over, please. Wait a minute. It's...
Okay?
Come on, go away!
My name is Kazan, and your wish is my command.
Huh?
I understand you have a dream.
But you're not a genie.
That's real life. I'm a genie in Kazan the movie.
But this is a commercial.
Same rules apply. Now make a wish.
To play football in the summer games.
They don't play football in the summer games.
Hey, you get to be a genie.
Good point.
Man, those are some powerful shoes.
It's your dream, but this is my planet.
Where does NAPA keep over 200,000 different parts? Right up here. Now remember, your belt tension on this is critical.
What kind of car is it?
Well, I'll sell you all the struts you want, but I wouldn't recommend putting them in without the right tools.
I'm sure we have it.
Okay, is it a 77 or a 78? Because they changed the carburetor in 78.
Actually, that's not a stupid question at all. I know what it used to be.
You don't stay at NAPA long handing out the wrong answers, and I'm not planning on going anywhere.
We keep America running.
So you're not Grant Hill. You could still win big this summer. Play McDonald's When the U.S. Wins, You Win game. You could win $10,000 instantly.
Welcome back to the Centennial Olympic Games. Wasting no time, right back out to track and field. Coverage of the men's long jump. Carl Lewis attempting to win this event for a fourth time, but with plenty of competition and with more again, Tom Hannon.
All right, Bob, in the gathering dusk here at Olympic Stadium, the crowd mesmerized by the long jump competition. And for an update, let's get over to Dwight Stones.
All right, Tom, Carl Lewis up on the runway for his second attempt. He is second in the order. Look at the statistics on him with the long jump. The U.S. is awfully dominant in this event. They've only lost it three times in the history of the games. And the last time that someone other than Carl Lewis won this event, it was the boycotted Moscow Olympics. Carl has no mark from the first round. And he didn't get much of the board on that one, so we know it's not a foul. At least he got up in the air. And by the way, this board is not a wooden board. It's a synthetic board, much like the one in Tokyo. 26-8.5 in the second round, so that moves him into second place and certainly assures that he will get all six jumps in this competition. He's starting to pick up his speed a little bit. Look at his knee drive, look at his arm drive. He did not check up too much, didn't take a look at the board, but he gave up 5 or 6 inches at the board. So that'll show that he's got a lot more distance left in him, starting to look more like a sprinter on the runway, which is the main thing that he brings to this event, aside, of course, from his fabulous technique when he is really jumping well. So he's got to feel a lot better now that he has a mark on the board. It's certainly going to be long enough that he will contest this entire final, but he did want to get a very big one in the first two rounds. Now Mike Powell, a very pensive look on his face. He knows that Carl is not playing. Powell, twice the silver medalist behind Lewis. At 31 years of age, this may be his last Olympic Games. We know it's Carl's last. And very close to the edge of the board on that one for Powell. He got most all of that board. Still looks like he's struggling down the runway. The speed just isn't there as he looks up in the stands for his coach, Randy Huntington, for any kind of advice. Now, Mike brings tremendous leaping and jumping ability to this event. His technique is not the best, and of course he's not the fastest guy on the runway because that belongs to Lewis. He's still not getting the height off the board that we saw from him in the early 90s, especially when he set the world record in Tokyo. He probably could have cleared 5.5 feet in the air on that Tokyo jump when he laid out. But again, he has a jump that will get him into the all set, six jumps, 26.9¾, so he now moves into second and bounces Carl down to third. Remember, Emmanuel Bang of France still leading the competition early. And Powell, body language looks a little unusual to me, and Carl pensive because he's not in the lead yet. So here are the standings after two full rounds. Bang is still leading, but Powell just behind him by 3/4 of an inch, and then Lewis another 1¼ behind that. Joe Green needs a good one to get into the final three jumps. Tom?
All right, Dwight. So Powell and Lewis in striking position, and we'll keep tracking the long jump as the evening progresses. Now back to the International Broadcast Center and Bob Costas.
Okay, Tom, it's all very exciting out there. Carl Lewis, Mike Powell, Emmanuel Bang, it's all well and good. But you know, folks, if you're like me, you feel there's been something missing here. The Olympic mascot hasn't been easy to find. People have wondered, is he shy? Is he injured? Did Izzy fail a drug test? A team of our top investigators went in search of the little blobby blue guy.
Once upon a time, in the city of the Olympic Flame, lived a citizen of the torch called Izzy. Word of his animated antics reached the outside world, which clamored for a closer look at this colorful creature. What is he? The world wondered. Denied permission by the elders of the torch to leave his fiery home, the teenager snuck away and found himself in the glare of negative publicity that burned hotter than 1,000 suns. Izzy, it turned out, was not what the world expected. And so, on the eve of the Olympics, Izzy vanished. Unlike his symbolic predecessors, Hodori and Kobe, he played no role in his city's opening ceremony. And while extremely important dignitaries in politics, sports, business, and entertainment were glimpsed in and around the Olympic ring, the malign mascot skulked through the shadows, a creature of mystery. All over Atlanta, people were asking, is he here? Is he there? Where is he? Where is he? Where is he?
Donde está Izzy?
Where is Izzy?
Clockwork, our crack research staff has finally uncovered the truth about Izzy. Rejected and lonely, the computer-generated creature hidden in the depths of the Olympic City. Somewhere so isolated, nobody could possibly find it. the local bottling plant of a certain unsanctioned soft drink. There, amidst the hum of heavy machinery, he sat drowning his sorrow in liter after liter of the forbidden product until his bloated, formless body threatened to burst. Rushed to a hospital, Izzy underwent emergency surgery. Doctors familiar with his cartoonish physiology were called in from the land of the torch. Taking Martin, they of course arrived in plenty of time to save his fully animated life. Since then, Izzy has been comfortably secluded in a posh downtown hotel, far from a madding crowd, living, as you see, the good life. He wants all his fans to know that he's alive and well, and with them at each and every Olympic venue, in spirit at least.
So there you have it, except for this note, detoxed and rested. There are signs that the Izzy exile is ending. He was spotted at the baseball venue recently, and through his official contacts, Izzy has scored track and field tickets to nearly every session. In fact, we think he's there tonight. Michael Johnson, Carl Lewis, how could even a media-shy mascot resist? Carl Lewis next, as a matter of fact. He's coming up after this. Is he ready for the long jump? Ah, there he is. We shall soon enough know. Yeah, once more. I can't tell you how proud I am of...
No, men behaving badly, quiz.
Are men smarter than sea cucumbers?
Smarter?
Are men smarter than salamanders?
Smarter?
Are men smarter than raccoons?
Men behaving badly, Wednesdays this fall on NBC.
Right?
Tomorrow on First Thing in the Morning.
Hundreds have come to peer at the site that still carries the scars of the blast. The evidence has been collected and the security increased. Now, just 2 days after the explosion, the fences come down. We'll go live to a shaken but determined Atlanta for the reopening of Centennial Park. Then, hospital nurses get a helping hand. A mechanical one, that is. Tomorrow, meet a robo-nurse.
Tomorrow on First Thing in the Morning, committed to Chicago.
Without limits, where anything is possible. AT&T believes communication can help make it happen. Because when people communicate, there's no limit to what they can do.
We have a wonderful 75 Lacroix Cabernet. Or an exquisite 58 Le Bourse-Mignon. Or a 62 Je Vous Pinot, if you're in the mood for...
No. Enough of that old stuff. Lady and I would prefer something fresh.
How about something in a lager? What do you got in a Budweiser from, say, early this month?
Budweiser. Brewery fresh taste. Strictly enforced. Claritin.
It's time. It's time.
Don't wait another minute for Claritin.
Claritin. I'll ask my doctor.
It's time to see your doctor.
Mr. Wilkin, the doctor will see you now.
At last, a clear day is here.
I want to know more about Claritin.
The doctor
yes,
will see you
Yes, ask
now.
Your doctor for a trial of Claritin. For free information and a $5 coupon toward a prescription for Claritin, call 1-800-CLARITIN.
At the track and field venue, Olympic Stadium, where the long jump competition continues. At last report, after two jumps, Carl Lewis stood in third place. For an update, let's go to Dwight Stones.
All right, Tom, as I told you before, Carl is up second in the order, so this is his third round jump. He said he wanted to hit a big one early in the competition. You can see his winning distances from the last three Olympic Games. Trying to tie Al Order for four consecutive gold medals in a single event, 35-year-old Carl Lewis. Oh, and it's the first time I have seen him run down the runway for real this entire year. And look at his reaction. He knows he just caught a big one. Finally got on the board, finally used that sprint speed that took him to a 9.9 400 meters back in May.
And watch the flash bulbs as Carl hits the board. Good concentration. He does sneak a peek, though, at the board. And look at all the flash. Gymnastics has got nothing on us. He looks over at the board to see what his distance is. That's unbelievable control. The amount of pressure that is on this man, he takes a peek at the distance board that's right next to the pit. Watch his head on this. As he sails past the 8-meter marks, watch his eyes looking over, and he saw that he cleared the board. He knew it was out past 8.5 meters, right at that. Now, let's watch the flash bulbs on this jump. And that is nothing like it was last night on his third qualifying jump. And this was his reaction to the distance. 27 feet, 10 and a half inches for Carl Lewis into the lead by more than a foot. So he maybe didn't get in the first two. And let's look at the family. There's Evelyn. It's amazing. She's actually watching the jump. She normally closes her eyes when Carl jumps. That's Carl's brother, Matt, William McKinley Lewis III, named after Bill Lewis. There next to Evelyn, and standing up, the man that looks like Carl's twin plus 40 pounds, that's Cleve Lewis. One of the rare times when Evelyn Lewis actually watches Carl perform. And even though Carl knows that this competition is far from here, from over, correction on the distance, 27, 10 and 3 quarters of an inch, 8 meters 50, right on the button, he knows this thing is not over. Tom?
All right. So Evelyn Lewis is able to see her son take the lead in the long jump. Bob?
Thanks, Tom. 27, 10 and 3 quarters, the longest jump anyone has had here yesterday or today. Lewis won in Barcelona with 28, 5 and a half. When we come back, the final of the men's 110-meter hurdles. Americans Alan Johnson and Mark Creer expected to contend, but Britain's Colin Jackson, the world record holder, is not to be overlooked. We'll be back in a few minutes.
Still to come from the Centennial Olympic Games, Michael Johnson, in search of unprecedented double gold, competing in his first final, the 400. And gymnastics, the event finals continue. In Barcelona, Shannon Miller won silver on the balance beam. Tonight, one last chance for individual gold. NBC's coverage will continue following your local news.
Imagine aliens invaded America in 1947. Imagine everything you know in history is a lie. Saturdays this fall, you will stop imagining and start believing. Dark Skies, The Storm is coming to Saturdays this fall on NBC.
From the Channel 5 newsroom, this is a Channel 5 Olympic news break.
Good evening, I'm Mark Sapelsa. It was a short message, one that proved deadly. Tonight, federal investigators say the man who called 911 to warn of the Olympic bomb said just 10 words. There's a bomb in Centennial Park. You have 30 minutes. And in fact, the bomb blew in less than 30, leaving one person dead, more than 100 people injured. The FBI says it's not ready to label anyone a suspect in the bombing. However, some composite sketches have been put together. Centennial Park has been shut down since the bombing, but is slated to reopen tomorrow. Ron Majors has more on that.
I'm Ron Majors in Atlanta, where the good news tonight is that things are almost back to normal. Most of the crowds have returned to the streets immediately surrounding Centennial Olympic Park. The park itself will reopen tomorrow morning. For now, you can see the Mix Tower, where the bomb blast actually occurred, and at the base of that tower, there are final repairs being made to the damage that was caused by that blast. Tomorrow, an official ceremony here, then the crowds will return, and we presume all will be normal except for what is described as an increased security presence at the park. More security personnel, but we are told the public will not be required to pass through a metal detector. The intention is to make sure that Centennial Olympic Park is still a public gathering place. I'm Ron Majors in Atlanta.
The Olympic bombing and TWA disaster have put airports across the country on alert. Travelers at Chicago's O'Hare face delays due to the heightened security procedures. Officials reported that they've received a dozen bomb threats since the downing of the TWA flight. Three people have been charged with misdemeanors. 8 others with felony charges. Prosecutors say every threat is taken seriously.
We're certainly going to back up the police and the airline personnel and continue to pursue these charges. It's a stupid thing to do, but it's also a very, very serious thing to do.
Bomb threats have also been received at Midway Airport. Now, the tension began 2 weeks ago with the crash of the TWA flight off Long Island. Tonight, divers are searching for a key piece of aluminum that may reveal if the plane was bombed. Sources believe the plane split in two just behind the first class section, and some family members of the 230 victims are concerned that not all the bodies may be found.
We're very concerned that at this stage, anyone would suggest that not every body could be recovered.
Family members also claim that the thrust of the investigation seems to be recovering pieces of metal instead of their loved ones. Tonight's Olympic postcard and a hospital room is the scene of a very special birthday party when we come back.
NBC5 Olympic team coverage is brought to you locally in part by Jewel-Osco, by Commonwealth Edison, by Chili's Grill and Bar, by Infinity, and by Circuit City.
Okay, you're driving along and you notice Ford Rangers everywhere. Well, that's because Ranger outsells both Chevy and Dodge. Yeah, more people choose Ranger over Chevy and Dodge. Maybe it's because Ranger looks cool, comes with a ton of standard equipment, and is sweet to drive. Or maybe it's because your Ford dealer makes it all affordable. Now get $1,000 cash back when you buy a new Ranger, or $1,400 cash back on a Ranger lease. Just $157 a month. So next time you're driving along, make sure you're on the truck that outsells both Chevy and Dodge. Ford Ranger. See your favorite Ford dealer today. There's more to a Ford.
Welcome to Olympic basketball teams.
As a host to this year's Olympic Games, me, Akeem Olajuwon, and the rest of American Dream Team are going to treat these guys for lunch.
We supervise. Eat these guys for lunch, not treat. Whoops.
So Akeem, when you need a world of purchase power, it's time to go for the gold. Visa Gold, it's everywhere you want to be.
For aches and pains, I take Tylenol. For fever, I take Tylenol. For headaches, I take Excedrin. Why do I do that? Because Excedrin relieves headaches better than Tylenol. How do I know? Was I convinced by all the clinical research? No, of course not. Of course not, I'm not convinced by charts and graphs. Are you? I'm convinced when my headaches go away.
Excedrin, the headache medicine, also available in gel tabs.
It was a good day for Julian Schneider. Today, friends, family, and well-wishers threw a birthday party for the boy who was shot in the head with a BB gun. About 20 Little Leaguers, buddies of Julian, showed up for his 12th birthday party. The gathering was held at Weiler Children's Hospital. Julian was shot in June, although he was sent home from the hospital. He had to come back because of an infection. Time now for tonight's Olympic postcard. A hello back home from Chicagoans in Atlanta for the 1996 Summer Games.
Hi, I'm Walt. I'm from Wilmette. I'm here at the Olympics to see basketball and swimming.
Join us for all the day's news tonight. Enjoy the Olympics.
This has been a Channel 5 Olympic News Break. Stay tuned for the Channel 5 News after the Olympics.
Every Tuesday at Builder Square, seniors can take 10% off almost all their purchases with our Seniors Discount Card. It's good throughout the store on nearly every item. Sign up today and start getting 10% off almost every purchase every Tuesday. It's only for seniors and only at Builder Square, America squared away.
Imagine a world without limits, where anything is possible. AT&T believes communication can help make it happen. Because when people communicate, there's no limit to what they can do.
A promise to report what's happening right now.
Useful stories, health breakthroughs, what's hot.
NBC5 News at 4:30.
Breaking news, whenever, wherever. plus weather and Target 5 consumer reports.
NBC 5 News at 5.
The day's news. Your first look at 4:30. The latest developments at 5.
Commitments you'd expect from NBC 5 News.
Committed to Chicago.
From the International Broadcast Center in Atlanta, here's Bob Costas.
The 110-meter hurdles, Roger Kingdom, Willie Davenport, Lee Calhoun, among the memorable names who have won gold in this event. The final is coming up, and to call it, Tom Hammond. Tom?
Thank you, Bob. From a jam-packed Olympic Stadium, one of the highlights of the evening, that 110-meter hurdle final that you mentioned, an event that the U.S. has won the gold medal in 17 of the previous 22 Olympic Games. And they have the favorites, three runners of the eight in the final here. And the favorite would be Alan Johnson, the current world champion.
Remember, Tommy tells us that he uses anger to motivate himself before a hurdles race. He says sometimes he wants to just kill those hurdles.
Mark Creer is competing with a broken left arm without a cast on it because he thinks it would throw off his balance. He didn't have a great run in the semifinal. He's in lane 8, but a courageous effort by Mark Creer nevertheless.
Lane 8 could be trouble for him because he's not in the mix. He's not in the middle of the race, but it could be just what he needs. Concentrate on his own lane. Let that sort of performance that he had in the second round come through.
Here are the runners in the men's 110-meter hurdle final. On the inside in lane 1 is Eric Bate of Cuba, just 21 years old, 7th at the World Championships last year. Lane 2, Kyle Vanderkuyt of Australia, the Australian national record holder, 5-time national champion. We saw the Aborigine compete earlier in this event. Kathy Freeman claiming the silver medal, the first Australian Aborigine to medal at the Olympics. Vanderkuyt would hope to be the second. 6'7", Florian Schwarthoff of Germany won his semifinal. He could be a victor here after finishing fifth in Barcelona. In lane 4 is Eugene Swift of Richmond, California. Quit hurdling when he got out of high school because he was only 5'2" tall. He was worried he couldn't clear the college hurdles. He has grown to 6 feet tall. He is in the Olympic final. Lane 5, Colin Jackson of Great Britain, native of Cardiff, Wales, world record holder, set the world record when he won the world championship in 1993. Lane 6 is Alan Johnson, the Tar Heel from North Carolina, quiet and shy, hoping to make a statement with a gold medal here. Lane 7 is Emilio Vie of Cuba, 29 years old. He was 6th in Barcelona. And in lane 8 is Mark Creer from Valencia, California, and the University of Southern California, outdoor champion while he was at USC. Second to Alan Johnson at the U.S. Olympic Trials, ranked number 1 in the world last year.
Tom, there are two races in a hurdles final. There's the race to the first hurdle, and then the struggle to maintain your composure while chaos reigns around you. People hitting hurdles, people hitting you sometimes as their arms swing. Alan Johnson says that if he can be ahead as of the fifth hurdle, he will win this Olympic title. Record
12.95, an Olympic record and a gold medal for Alan Johnson of the U.S.
You know, Tom, he may have won that race to the first hurdle, but chaos was reigning in his lane. He was hitting hurdles all over the place. Some people say he's too small to be a great hurdler at 5'10, 165. He doesn't have the bulk to knock those hurdles out of the way. But somehow he got it done.
And the U.S. claims the gold medal for the 18th time in 23 runnings of this event.
I'm sure his coach, Curtis Fry, will first congratulate him and second say that was one of the worst races from a technical standpoint of your career, but who cares when you win?
So Alan Johnson wins. Mark Creer got second, so a 1-2 finish for the U.S. Very close for third. They're still trying to figure it out with the photo.
Pitts hurdle number one, Pitts hurdle number two, Clips hurdle number three, finally gets over four, Pitts five, but he's still in the lead. Remember, he said if he was in the lead at the fifth hurdle, he would win the race. Pitts six, Pitts seven, Pitts eight, Pitts nine, smashes 10, and still wins the race.
He cut a wide swath down the track. Mark Creer leans to get second on the extreme outside, as we said, very, very close for the bronze medal. Listen to the hurdles Alan Johnson hits. Johnson wins the gold medal, and the U.S. finishes 1-2. Florian Schwarthoff did claim the bronze for Germany. 1-2 finish in the 110 hurdles. Now back to Bob Costas.
Alan Johnson, not so much clearing him as just getting by him, but it's good enough for gold, as Tom said, 1-2 for the Americans, with Creer second. The 6'7" German Florian Schwarthoff takes the bronze. Colin Jackson of Great Britain, the world record holder, finishes out of the medals. He came in fourth. Coming up shortly, another Johnson, Michael Johnson's 400-meter final, chapter one of his effort to win the unprecedented 200-400 double. The world record in this event, held by Butch Reynolds, is 43.29. Johnson has run as fast as 43.39, the second fastest time ever, and many expect him to challenge the Reynolds record tonight. But when we come back after this commercial, the Enberg moment, the subject coaches, and we're back right after this.
You're 11 inches high, 8.5 wide. You're up against documents from companies 10 times your size. But Xerox has everything you need to compete. Printers, copiers, even a document work center that prints, copies, faxes, and scans. Plus, all the support you need. Because when all they see of you is 8.5 by 11, you better leave a lasting impression.
The Document Company, Xerox.
Not everything you see in life is perfect, but that doesn't mean you can't see it perfectly, with perfect clarity, perfect comfort, the way you were meant to see, through AccuView contact lenses, precision crafted for exceptional vision, ultra thin for lasting comfort. That's why it's the world's number one contact lens. It's the perfect balance, 20/20 vision, 20/20 comfort. AccuView disposable contact lenses. See your eye doctor for a free trial.
What makes an Olympian? Speed. Flexibility. Making the impossible look easy. One company does just that. Motorola. Years of experience and proven technology made it possible for Motorola to create a wireless communication system powerful enough for the largest games in history. So when you see the impossible at these Olympic Games, look a little closer. Motorola. What you never thought possible.
What you're thinking.
Hey, cows.
What the Bravada's thinking.
Mud. 104% gray. Reduced slippage via viscous clutch.
With its exclusive smart track system, the Bravada automatically reacts to changing road conditions. So with no buttons to push or levers to pull, you can think about more important things.
I wonder who invented barbed wire.
That would be Joseph Glidden.
Wide Track Grand Prix from Pontiac, proud sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team, presents Dick Enberg's Moments.
Well, Dick, somewhere along the line, you were a teacher yourself, so you always have an interest in those who teach and coach.
That's for sure, and even a little bit of coaching as well. And tonight we're going to focus in that direction, Bob. Often we can care more and feel more about the athletes when we see them through the eyes of their coaches. Each of the hundreds of coaches here have developed their own unique style over countless practices and games. Some have had to resort to an on-the-spot emergency plan.
Croatia's water polo coach, Bruno Silic, suspended from coaching in the gold medal game against Spain. He was forced then to coach modern. He went clandestine cellular, received by a hooded substitute. And through this illegal coaching relay, Croatia took a first half lead 3-1. But Spain protested, and despite every effort to hide the phone, including the old sneak it into the trainer's bag trick, officials found them out. Stripped of his direct line, cellular Silic saw Spain win 7-5, leaving him in defeat to ponder the merits of satellite sonar. Russian volleyball coach Nikolai Karpol, your basic yell coach, a complete contrast to Dream Team coach Lenny Wilkins, who knows his best coaching is to silently stay out of the way. High, loud volume versus soft four, all the way to a world record and to a favorite for the gold here in Atlanta. Their relationship has been more coach-athlete than father-son, so much so that Yanni calls him by his first name, Essa, never dad or father. In the 200-meter IM, Yanni was the favorite. Essa, without a seat for the final, left fighting for any view with glimpses through the crowd, chanting Yanni's name in encouragement. Yanni barely edged out for the gold. The only sign of any disappointment by Essa, a mild slap of the program. The swimming silver is the best ever for Finland. Yanni is 22. Maybe now it's time to call his coach Dad.
It's interesting, Bob, as Americans count all the gold medals, Yanni returned home to Helsinki today. We saw footage of it. The Helsinki airport, wall-to-wall people to celebrate a silver medal. They've given him a new home, the new lot next door. I mean, he is a national hero.
You know, that's something to remember. Michael Johnson, Carl Lewis, they do what they do. They're wonderful athletes. They get lots of fame, but they go alongside dozens of other sporting heroes in our country. For some of these other athletes, whether it's weightlifting or some obscure sport or swimming, a more prominent sport, they become a national hero.
Now that's the case of Yanni Sievinen tonight.
All right, when we come back, the aforementioned Michael Johnson, the 400-meter final, one of the big moments of the games, has arrived. It's coming up next.
Get over. The new 1997 Wide Track Grand Prix from Pontiac. Call toll-free 1-888-97-WIDER for your free video information package. See how wider is better.
We knew him long before the Olympic trials. We knew her before she was a medal hopeful. We knew him before he ever wrote a qualifying heat. We know them because they work here at UPS. And through a program we created to identify potential Olympic athletes from among our employees, we offered them financial support and flexible work hours so they might accomplish something the entire world will know them for.
So I hear he's moving to the corner office.
How's he do it?
I don't know. Yesterday he spent an hour with some life insurance guy.
That's good time management?
Well, Winters gave the agent his name.
Winters, as in CEO.
Mm-hmm.
How's he doing? Have you heard from the quiet company? Northwestern Mutual Life.
For the man who would be king. For the man who would dare challenge Mercury, golden wings on his feet. The message has been sent to the farthest corners of the earth, but only heard in a small Texas town. Where a man trains with the passion of a world champion day after day after day. A man who has battled through the disappointment of Olympic defeat. To show us the remarkable, what is possible. Michael Johnson. Wearing shoes of gold, the man who would be king, Michael Johnson, Waco, Texas, attempting to do what no man has ever done in Olympic competition, win both the 400 and 200 meters. This is the 400 meter final.
Tom, you know, there have been very few special moments in the history of track and field, moments that separate themselves from all the other great achievements and moments. Jesse Owens, 6 world records in 1 hour in 1935. Roger Bannister running the first sub-4-minute mile in 1954. Bob Beamon's world record long jump at the 68 Olympics. This has the opportunity, the chance, to be a special moment for Michael Johnson. This is a world record track. He doesn't need to set a world record to be the man. He's already the man. But how can he not? 100-meter world record on this track, 200-meter world record on this track.
Final, men's 400 meters.
Michael Johnson, who has been compared so often to the man you mentioned, Jesse Owens, not only in his running style, in his accomplishments, but in the manner that he carries himself, the dignity that he seems to possess.
From the USA.
And a lot of it has to do with his family. He tells the story of after the 200-meter disappointment when he failed to make the final in Barcelona, that he broke down in tears outside of Estadio Olimpico, and his father came to console him. The father, who along with his mother, Father Paul, along with his mother Ruby, used to hold family sessions, counseling sessions, where they talk about life and about life goals, as we see them there in the picture. He used to tutor them in the summer for the fall classes in school, probably never dreaming that what they called their nerdy son would become the best athlete in track and field.
Here are the lanes in this 400-meter final, and in lane one is a real surprise. Alvin Harrison of the United States, who just started training seriously in December. Not too long ago, he and his twin brother Calvin, also a runner, were living in a 1980s vintage Mustang automobile. Calvin in the front seat, Alvin in the back. Now he's in the Olympic final. Lane two, Davis Kamoga, 28 years old from Uganda, had a personal best in the quarterfinal. It would be a long shot should he win tonight. Lane three, Roger Black of Great Britain from Portsmouth, England, birthplace of Charles Dickens. Roger's father, a doctor there, and Black has been very much in need of a doctor much of his career, plagued by injuries, but healthy now. In fact, he gave up medical school to concentrate on track. In lane four is Michael Johnson, born in Dallas, grew up in a home that valued education over athletic prowess. Of the five children
of Paul and Ruby Johnson. Only Michael became an athlete, but all five children graduated from college. Michael didn't become serious about running until he was a junior in high school, now poised on the brink of Olympic history. He's won 54 straight 400-meter finals. In lane five, Roxburgh Martin of Jamaica. Right next to Michael Johnson, which can be intimidating in itself, but if he takes a look at that game face, can't help but get a little weak in the knees. Roxburgh, as we said, does have U.S. ties. He is scheduled to be a senior in the fall at Oklahoma University in Norman. In lane six is another Jamaican, Davian Clark, also with U.S. ties. He's the current NCAA champion. He'll be a junior this fall at the University of Miami in Florida. Lane seven is Ibrahim Ismail of Qatar, just 24 now. He was seventh as a 20-year-old in the 400-meter run in Barcelona. And completing the field in lane eight, 22-year-old Ewan Thomas of Great Britain, who was third at this year's British Championships. There's the field for the 400-meter final.
Talking about this race from a competitive perspective for a moment, Roxburgh Martin and Davian Clark, who are just outside of Michael Johnson in lanes five and six, like to go out fast. That means they'll take Michael Johnson with them, take him towards a fast time, take him towards his Olympic victory.
To make Olympic history, Michael must first win the 400. Swing around the back stretch.
We haven't seen him going full speed in any of the qualifying rounds. He's been holding back, trying to save something perhaps for this final in the 200 meters, but he's running now.
Now he's kicked it into gear, and Michael Johnson reaches back, coming to the head of the straightaway, and Michael Johnson has the lead. Now through the straight, and Michael Johnson opens up a huge advantage. Michael Johnson is first, and he's cruising for the finish. Michael Johnson coming home all by himself. Michael Johnson is halfway to history.
43-49, a new Olympic record for Michael Johnson.
Setting the Olympic record, nipping the mark set by Quincy Watts in Barcelona. No world record for Michael, but perhaps if you want to concentrate on winning two gold medals and doing the double that no one has ever done, perhaps the wisest strategy. Certainly no one pressed him in this race.
It never was in question. Michael certainly ran within himself the first 200 meters, and you were right to spot it. It was around that turn where he really started to run, and a very impressive home stretch, gapping the field. This was not a victory. He demolished the best 400-meter runners in the world.
Roger Black of Britain will claim the silver medal, and Davis Kamoga of Uganda the bronze, as Michael dons the stars and stripes for his victory lap. Well, the shoes of gold, just as Gail Devers had the fingernails of gold, are two for two on the prophetic gold color. There are those shoes, specially designed by Michael himself. I don't think anyone called it arrogance either when he showed up in gold shoes. Paul and Ruby have seen their son take an Olympic gold medal. You'll remember in Barcelona, he didn't run in the 400. He ran in the 200, was the favorite to win.
came down with a case of food poisoning, or the after effects of food poisoning, and his Olympic dream was not there. Someone asking for those gold shoes. And so for all he has accomplished, for all his acclaim, for all of his celebrity, this is his first Olympic medal.
Individual medal, of course. He did win the gold in the relay there. But it's interesting, the development that you point about in this acclaim, that in Barcelona, I went to a dream team game with Michael Johnson and his coach Clyde Hart. We sat in the stands. Every Japanese and European spectator stopped, paid homage to Michael, said hello. The Americans walked by, didn't know him at all. That can't happen anymore with Michael Johnson.
He's been on the cover already of every news magazine. He's been mobbed like a rock star wherever he goes. And when you went around the stadium tonight in his race, the flashbulbs followed him like the wave.
Tom, it's hard to appreciate how hard it is to change from being a 400-meter runner to a 200-meter runner and back. The 400 meters is about measuring out your endurance, your sprint endurance over a whole lap. The 200 meters is about controlled fury over a short distance. Michael Johnson maintained his composure for the first 200 meters and then started to let it loose. Probably recalling the fact that in this last 200 meters, he's covering the same ground he covered when he set the world record for 200 meters on this track. Get a great view of the classic style of Michael Johnson. The erect posture and the up and down action of those knees and those feet. Tremendous turnover.
That close-up picture, almost like poetry to see him running, and the flashballs throughout Olympic Stadium. And I hope the people brought plenty of batteries for their flash tonight with King Carl, Carl Lewis, and the man who would be king, Michael Johnson, in action at the stadium. Michael Johnson is halfway there. The Olympic gold and Olympic record time. Roger Black second, Davis Camoga is third.
MCI presents the last 24 hours of the Olympics. How does American business communicate? With Network MCI, that's how.
Given the opportunity to pull together 55 different countries.
We came to MCI and said, we need connectivity.
Germany, Egypt,
Uruguay, Guam,
Switzerland and Sweden,
Norway and Jamaica.
This was not a one-person effort.
The unique thing is coordinating that. We all looked at each other and said, wow, we just assembled this team from around the world.
The customers were just so incredibly pleased that they actually sent a letter saying what an outrageous success it was.
How does MCI serve American business? With people like these, that's how. Feeling safe, being secure. It's why more families rely on Buick LeSabre than any other full-size sedan. Peace of mind from LeSabre.
Way down upon the Swan River, far, far away.
The world is practiced for the Olympic Games in Atlanta.
You are not just whistling Dixie.
You are not just whistling Dixie.
How do you all?
Please pass me a grit, please.
Why, I do declare.
And now that they're here, there's only one thing they need to say.
I have Visa.
You all?
Visa, the only card accepted at the 1996 Olympic Games in Atlanta.
You're welcome back.
No, wait a minute. That's a tricky one, though.
They call it a frog kick because that's how frogs kick.
Well, those synchronized swimmers are twins, aren't they?
No. Flip the guy a half Nelson.
Jab right there in the face.
It's not a splash.
It's so little, it's called a sploosh.
People everywhere are really getting into the games because of McDonald's When the U.S. Wins, You Win game. Just pull and win free McDonald's food when the U.S. wins any medal or even $1 million instantly.
You gotta be perky. Judges like it when you're perky.
Just pull and win. Get to McDonald's and get into the games.
Tomorrow night, it's an Olympic first, the exciting debut of women's mountain biking with its most dominant star, American Julie Furtado. Plus, the gold medalists gather again in the first ever Gymnastics Champions Gala. And women's springboard diving. That's all tomorrow night early at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific on NBC.
Olympic Stadium shimmering in the Atlanta evening, still abuzz after Michael Johnson's run. Our aerial photography being provided by Goodyear Infinitred. And from high above Olympic Stadium, let's go down to the floor of the stadium itself, where Chris Collinsworth is with the man.
Hi, Tom. Thanks. Michael, congratulations. Your first individual gold medal. How's it feel?
Well, you know, first of all, I want to dedicate this race to Alice Hawthorne, who was killed in the Centennial Park bombing. And it's extra special for me because it is my first gold medal individual, and I've been saying all along that this has nothing to do with Barcelona, but now that I've got it, it certainly makes me feel a lot better about what happened in Barcelona. It was a great race. I felt real good out there, and it's unfortunate that Butch couldn't be in the race, but I went ahead and went out there and just did what I had to do.
An Olympic record. Are you disappointed you didn't get the world record here tonight?
No, I'm not disappointed. I'm extremely pleased with my win, and that's what I came here for, is to win, and now I'm going to move on and get ready for the 200, and I'll have other opportunities to break the world record.
You know the 200 is going to be a bigger challenge for you with Frank Fredericks in that race. How quickly can you get your mind going in that direction?
I've got 48 hours to get ready. I'll be ready in about 2 hours.
Sounds good. Good luck.
Got to say hi to Marlon. Ray Crockett.
Tom, back to you.
I don't think anybody will argue with him either. He was ready tonight, Michael Johnson, a special athlete. And, of course, referring to Barcelona when he was the favorite in the 200 after effects of food poisoning, unable to even make the final, much less win a medal. His first individual medal at the Olympics is gold in the 400. Michael Johnson electrified this crowd. In his victory lap, one of the most popular athletes now. You heard him talk about Butch Reynolds, saying sorry he couldn't be in the race. Butch Reynolds last night injured in his semifinal heat, unable to make the final, but remains the world record holder. And Alvin Harrison, the young man who not too long ago was living out of his car, as we said, just started training seriously 7 or 8 months ago, finished a very respectable fourth in this 400-meter final. So the man who would be king has his first gold on target for his historic 200-400 double. Now let's go to Dwight Stones for a report on the long jump.
All right, Tom, this is Carl Lewis. He is leading the competition by a long way with his 27:10¾ third round jump, which means he will jump last in the order. They reverse the order. And Mike Powell, very pensive, and I don't like that body language, that furrowed brow. He doesn't believe it. Now, here's a guy, Joe Green. He gives everybody a heart attack. In Barcelona, 4 years ago, he was in the same position going into his third jump. He's 11th in the order as well. If he doesn't improve, he doesn't get the last three. And he's over that 8-meter mark, and he will get three more jumps. 27 feet, a half inch, all the way from 11th place to second place after being in jeopardy of not making the final three jumps. He did this in Barcelona, and in round four, he jumped far enough for the bronze medal. Right now, he is in silver medal contention. Joe Green tried to break Jesse Owens' school record at Ohio State, wasn't able to do so. What is the deal? The board doesn't move. Why is everybody looking at it tonight? You're not supposed to look at the board the last six strides, but it doesn't matter. He hit it, and he went far enough to make it into the last three, and with Joe Green around, anything can happen. And Ivan Pedrosa, the 23-year-old world champion from Cuba, that injury just didn't give him enough time to get back into shape. He finishes 12th many people's favorite to win it. And many people's favorite to win it tonight is this man also, Mike Powell. He is in fourth place. Now, Americans are 1, 2, and 4. This, his fourth round attempt. Powell's just jogging down the runway, checks up his step, and he looks back after a very long effort and sees another foul. That one might have been good enough to get up into the top three, but he wastes it. Powell desperately wanting to break Carl Lewis's heart by winning the gold medal here. He has two silvers in his trophy case along with the world record, twice the world champion. He looks up for Randy Huntington to give him some type of idea about what to do with his step. And there's Carl. He passed in the fourth round. So he is just going to sit back and let everybody else come back to him. So Carl Lewis is leading after four rounds with 27, 10 and 3/4. Joe Green, 10 inches behind. Emmanuel Bang still hanging in there for third. Mike Powell just barely out of the medals. Remember, the U.S. has swept this event twice the last two Olympics. James Beckford in fifth. Got to be careful of that guy.
All right, Carl Lewis in first place after Michael and others have jumped. So Carl Lewis on track to close his career with gold. Bob?
Thanks again, Tom. You know, for all the other great events at all the other venues around the Olympic Games, for many, the classic signature events of the Olympic Games have always been, always will be, the track and field events. It doesn't get much better than tonight. The courage of silver medalist Ana Quirote from Cuba, and then Michael Johnson winning the 400, and Carl Lewis, perhaps on the verge of history, will be going back for all that. A note on Michael Johnson, 43.49, off Butch Reynolds' world record of 43.29, as Tom and company noted. It's also off Johnson's personal best at last year's World Championships of 43.39. Since he leaves everybody in his wake, it's easy to forget the other medalists. They were Roger Black of Great Britain taking the silver, and Davis Kamogo of Uganda, who becomes the second ever Olympic track and field medalist from his country, the first rather famous John Akibua, who won the 400-meter hurdles in 1972. He took gold. When we come back, gymnastics, the event finals. We'll start with a balance beam, which happens to be the best event for 14-year-old Dominique Moceanu of Houston, Texas. Back with that after these messages. There goes Dominique. Now it's Shannon Miller.
Prepare for the future. But the question remains, will we?
Are in Atlanta, but the games will be everywhere. The Bud World Party, a great time to share a Bud with friends, no matter where you are. Budweiser, proud sponsor of the 96 Summer Games.
Question, why would a school like this hire a teacher like this?
What up?
Yeah, he's wild, but at least the other teachers have some advice for the new guy.
I just always take the chair facing the door. A disgruntled student comes in, you've got him in your sights.
You're afraid of prep school kids?
What are they going to do to you?
Four words for you, Tom. Lyle and Eric Menendez.
The comedy Heir Apparent. Mr. Rhodes, Mondays this fall on NBC.
Welcome to a sold-out, over 30,000 people here, Georgia Dome. I'm John Tesh, along with Tim Daggett and Elfie Schlegel. Beth Rujak's on the gym floor. We're getting set for the final night of gymnastics, and it begins on balance beam. There is Shannon Miller, Olympic gold medalist in the team competition. Carrie Strug, who just moments before this competition was slated to begin, withdrew from her final event. Dominique Moceanu, the other American who is going to be performing on the beam. The beam is difficult, it is daunting, and here is a look. The beam. It stretches 16 and a half feet long and stands 47 inches high. The width, the size of a videotape. The beam is all about the flight, the footwork, and the tumbling. And tonight, it's a farewell for Shannon Miller, who makes her last Olympic appearance. And first on the beam from Romania, Alexandra Marinescu. Romanian team finished third to the U.S. in the team competition. In the all-around, Romania has been superb. This was supposed to be Lavinia Milosevic, but at the last minute, coach Octavian Belu decided to pull her out, and it's being regarded as, whoa, I was going to say a chance for Marinescu.
I was just going to say, John, she was the silver medalist or at the 96 World Championships. Thought it was going to be a good switch because this is typically her event.
Alexandra is only 15 years old. She had qualified for the individual all-around and she was pulled out in favor of Simona Aminov, who last night you saw won a gold on the vault. It is no fun going on being first.
Really has had a rough Olympic Games. Remember, this was an athlete that they felt would really shine here at the Olympics and make a name for herself. And this is her event, as I said, but very uncharacteristic for any Romanian gymnast to fall. Oh, very, very disappointing routine.
Alexandra Marinescu. The cheers are for a young lady who is 195 days younger than Marinescu at 14. Dominique Moceanu. She finished ninth in the all-around. Considering the problem that she's had with a stress fracture in her leg, it's amazing she was even here.
That's it.
This is one of two chances, as you look at Bella Caroli, she has for an event final medal.
Balance beam is all about getting a good start, being relaxed, being confident.
Ball.
There's Marta Caroli, who is the beam coach and also the Olympic coach.
Dominique has been on a finals podium before. She was a silver medalist at the World Championships last year in Sabai, so she knows this kind of pressure.
Who's scoring 8.462.
score for Alexandra Marinescu, 8.462.
Overemphasize how important it is to get off to a good, clean start.
And right off the top, her key acrobatic pass right here. Four moves in a row.
Oh!
Oh!
Oh, oh my goodness.
Of course.
Oh, jeez.
I tell you, everybody's heart stops.
Including mine. A fall on the apparatus, of course, is as costly as falling off the balance beam. It's a 5/10 deduction. Very surprising. This is typically one of her strongest moves, but she missed her foot going into that last layout.
The second foot on her second layout just slides right off, so she can't get the height. Oh, geez.
She is so fortunate she wasn't seriously hurt.
Oh, boy.
What a hard fighter. I don't know how she got herself back up there. Well, Chatter's score a 9-1-2-5. We'll be right back.
NBC's coverage of the Centennial Olympic Games is brought to you by IBM, creators of the official Atlanta Games website, and by Visa, worldwide partner of the 1996 Olympic Games. It's everywhere you want to be.
Hi, I'm Danny DeVito. I just directed a movie called Matilda.
I think there's something wrong with that girl.
It stars Mara Wilson, the little tyke from Mrs. Doubtfire. This movie's got action. Heart. Triumph. And food. It has food. It has everything except kissing. There's no kissing. Matilda starts Friday, August 2nd. Go see it.
Rated PG.
This is big news. This is unbelievable. I gotta let everybody know.
Join friends and family free and get 1 free hour of calls automatically every month to other MCI customers. No name, no list, free calls every month. There's no better savings than free, honey. Call now to sign up for this new plan, friends and family free. Free calls, whoopee!
Why is it that wrinkles on men are supposedly distinguished and on women they're not? Women have to fight it. I've tried everything. I have a museum of old products that are collecting dust somewhere in my house. Best thing I ever did for my skin was to go to my doctor. I don't have the little wrinkles went away. There's a smoothness. It looks good without makeup. To get up in the morning, look in the mirror, and just, I'm enough. I love that.
Find out how your doctor can help you fight wrinkles. Call 1-800-5-NO-MAKEUP.
Just for the feel of it, the pure appeal of it, just for the taste of it, Diet Coke. Just hit the road with it, any time or place with it, just for the taste of it, just for the thrill of it, just for the taste of it, Diet Coke.
NBC's coverage of the Centennial Olympic Games is brought to you by Coca-Cola. Cheering is thirsty work, always for the fans, always Coca-Cola.
Dominique Moceanu, who had a horrible fall on the balance beam. Her score is 9-1-2-5, and she's followed by Dina Kochetkova. There are eight gymnasts on each piece of apparatus, and very simply, the highest score gives us the gold medalist, and silver and bronze follow. Kochetkova is 19 from Moscow, representing Russia. Shannon Miller will be coming up right after Kochetkova, the only other American in this final. Moceanu has floor exercise still to come.
Take a look at this tumbling pass right here. A lot of twisting in this balance beam routine. That is almost solid.
Very, very difficult, though. Most gymnasts just perform a regular back handspring. She does it with a full twist and then continues down the beam.
She has scored a 9-8-2-5 and twice here in Atlanta so far. Optionals and then the all-around.
As Elfie said, a lot of twisting elements in this routine. Capitalizes on a strength that she has. Once again.
That is the third twisting element, the same move, done three different times, but she's done it from a different entry. Of course, in the finals, the judges are demanding that much more difficulty. So she's added a skill, just the discount.
Other than that little bobble, a big routine for Dina Kochetkova. She won a silver, the Russian women's team. And you know, the three of us sat in this very same position 4 years ago, and every time you're watching women's gymnastics, it always seems to be the Olympic story is told on the balance beam. It has been for Shannon Miller as well. Miller will be next to go as Kochetkova waits for her score. This is her swan song. She is replacing. She is here after winning six Olympic medals.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, we ask your cooperation.
Five in Barcelona in the gold here.
Do not use the flash on your camera. It is once again very.
She replaced Carey on the vault only. Carey is up in the skybox watching.
Steve Nunu, before the meet began, told me this is Shannon's 30th routine in Olympic competition. And he says, I like that number.
And you know, it's there for the taking. I think Dina Kochetkova left the door a little bit open. She had a couple of little wavers in her routine. And when Shannon Miller is on, she...
9737, excuse me, Elsie, 9737.
Yeah, there's some room there.
Shannon's wrist for the longest period of time was been wrapped to protect against the tendonitis that has bothered her. Just before Barcelona, remember, she had a micro screw inserted into her elbow following an injury there. And being introduced one last time here in Atlanta.
The only thing Shannon Miller wants, needs to add to her Olympic trophy case, an individual Olympic gold medal. Right here tumbling pass on the beam.
Two layouts. She's on. And this move, folks, at home, is called the Miller.
Oh, this is beautiful. This is beautiful. She is saying, stick the dismount. Stick the dismount.
Just
right.
One of her coaches. The first coach you saw her grab was Peggy Liddick, who's the beam coach. Scores up 9-8-6-2. Shannon Miller is the leader in the Olympic Games. And now, the individual all-around gold medalist, Lilia Otepaeva.
Well, to follow Shannon Miller, this is going to be a tough act to follow. And Lilia has had problems in the past on the balance beam, of course. Certainly not the other evening when she took the all-around crown. But I'll show you the move where she has had problems, and it's coming up right here. The third skill is very, very difficult. She's on. Aerial front walkover. You know, John, that routine by Shannon Miller was absolutely incredible. She was solid, didn't move. The dismount was the highest degree of difficulty, an E element. Slight waver right there.
Yes, that's...
This is what it's going to come down to.
Exactly.
What Lilia obviously does so well, she has great extension, beautiful toe point.
Lilia fell on the beam this spring. She broke a rib, cracked another.
Same dismount as Shannon Miller. It was a great routine, but I honestly think that Shannon Miller's routine was more original and a little bit more difficult.
Miller has to sit and wait. Following Lilia's all-around victory, she received a congratulatory note from the president of the Ukraine.
How would you like to lose a gold medal because of that little tiny balance check?
But the dismount was great. Same dismount as Shannon Miller, as I mentioned, an E element, the most difficult in gymnastics. Just a little tiny step. The judges should look at that.
But score to beat. It's going to be close.
Score to beat is a 9-8-6-2. Podkopayeva's score is up. A 9-8-2-5, which puts her in second behind Miller. Three more gymnasts to go. Shannon Miller is waiting to see if she will take home a gold.
Out, we're part of the biggest event during the summer games, the beer run.
The Bud World Party continues around the clock, around the world.
This is the most advanced case of permanent surprise I've ever seen.
What caused it?
It's the new reduced fat Doritos. Uh-huh.
They do taste surprisingly good.
We'll do everything we can, Chuck. We're doctors.
New reduced fat Doritos tortilla chips. Surprisingly good.
Someday, my office will have a window. Someday, my boss will be me. Someday, I will meet the man of my dreams. Guess not today.
The Chevy Camaro's 200 horsepower, 3800 V6. Therapeutic, isn't it?
What'd you get there, Trev?
This is new handbag.
Black for evening wear, eh, mate?
For your information, the blokes at the Olympics are relying on these lot.
That's a flaming runt.
Yeah. You know what? They're going to be even smaller when the games come to Sydney.
Smaller in Sydney? Get out of here.
Also from the Ukraine. She is 15 years old. She is challenging the leader, who is an American, Shannon Miller.
It will be tough for this young lady, following those two great balance beam routines, the youngest on this Ukrainian team, and a bit of a surprise to have made it into the event finals. Not a lot of experience here.
Actually took a little bit of a spill in the warm-ups just moments ago.
Lenko qualified seventh coming into today's finals. The highest score there was a 9-7 for her on her optional beam set the other day. Oh. Already giving away such valuable tenths.
Gymnast from the Ukraine besides Polkapayeva to qualify for an event final.
This was the spill that she had in the warm-up. Very close call on the dismount. No problem there.
Her mother, Galia, was involved in ballet and ice skating, and her father was a track and field star. But any little mistake will take you out of the running for the gold medal position, which right now is owned by Shannon Miller. Remember, in the all-around, Shannon was in silver medal position before a mistake. Gina Gojin. Next for Romania, there are two athletes left, Gojin and Rosa Galieva.
The thing that this young lady has going for her more than anything else is she is one of the toughest kids I've ever seen. She is not one to have pressure get the best of her.
No. No, she has three Olympic medals so far here. Team bronze, all around silver, bronze in the vault.
You know, she's not very flashy in her gymnastic movements, but as you said, Tim, very consistent. And of course, she's got some ground to make up here with Marinescu having fallen.
Let's take you back to 1994 Worlds.
This was the team world championships in Dortmund, Germany. And it was one of the scariest falls that I saw in this competition. And at this point in time, Gina was very consistent, could always count on her. And to see this spill, just missing her foot, very similar to what Moceanu did. So she has had a history here. She got up, finished the routine.
Actually went to floor exercise after that and did a fantastic routine. As I said, she is a tough customer.
If you just joined us, Dominique Moceanu had a fall that to me looked as serious as that on the balance beam. She recovered and continued, but she stands in fifth place. Olga Teslenko's score, 9.625, which puts her in fourth ahead of Moceanu. Miller can only sit in meditation and see if anybody can chip away at what would be a gold medal. Gojin and the rest of the Romanians living with that legacy that Nadia built.
Right off the bat, she's got a risky element.
What you're going to see throughout this entire routine are combinations of jumps. You will not be seeing that same skill that we saw Gina perform at the 94 World Championships, the one that she took such a bad spill on.
She's doing exactly what Gina Gojin does. She does not the most exciting stuff, but so far, absolutely, positively, no deductions.
Unfortunately, I think this routine lacks the excitement value that we've seen from Miller, Lilia Prokopaeva. This is probably one of the most difficult combinations in her routine. It's her dismount, two flip-flops into a double back. Yeah, John, it was clean, as Tim said, hitting every element, no waivers whatsoever, but I'm sorry, it just didn't have the excitement value for me.
Well, the score she's going to have to beat is a 9.862, which is Miller's score. It's now Miller, Prokopaeva, and Dina Kochetkova, 1-2-3.
Almost flawless exercise, but just not the take-your-breath-away gymnastics that we've seen so far from Prokopaeva and certainly Shannon Miller.
Or that you expect in an event final.
Shannon Miller, who already has a silver Olympic Games medal from 92 on the beam. One last person to go. Gojin score a 9.787, which puts her in third place. So indeed, it is one person left that can take the gold away from Miller. Now, Rosa was pulled out of the all-around in Barcelona at the last minute, even though she qualified. She pulled out in favor of Tatiana Gutsu. The coach is saying she was injured. She was not injured. And these Olympics stand as her chance for redemption. She was the one, remember, on the floor exercise when Carrie Strug was being carried out of the arena on a stretcher. The American cheers so loud she could not hear her floor music. She was decimated, left the podium crying.
Well, so far she is on, already opening up with a very difficult mount, just completing her most difficult acrobatic series. This is an athlete that could score big. She's European champion.
I was going to say that she does have the goods. Challenge the
smoke. Well,
not
it.
Anymore. Not anymore.
From Yeva. She's got to get it back together. Silver and bronze still in contention. Miller is now a lock for the gold medal. Her coach, Leonid Arkayev, has said it's his biggest dream in Atlanta to see Rosa earn a medal in the all-around. She already has a silver team.
She gave up.
That does it.
Yeah.
Rosa Gallieva was the only one that could take the gold away from Shannon Miller, and this audience is on their feet. Miller has left the stadium to prepare for the medal ceremony, and the audience wants her back.
Oh, congratulations, brother. Oh.
Shannon Miller needs to come out for a curtain call.
Good things happen to good people, I'm telling you. I'm telling you.
What a story, this Shannon Miller story. You said it, Tim. That's the one thing she needs for her trophy case. The most decorated American gymnast in history up until this point, and this just cements that.
So well deserved. What a great ending for her. What a fantastic ending.
There she is. The crowd can see her now. After that team gold, it seemed like her week just fell apart here in Atlanta, and time after time we saw her make missteps and just throw it away, and now Shannon Miller is gold. Ilya Pokopaeva, silver. Gina Gojin, bronze.
One of the best nights of the Olympic Games so far. Michael Johnson in the 400. Now Shannon Miller with her first ever individual gold. Still to come, diving. And when we come back after this message, the conclusion of the long jump competition from the Olympic Stadium. Don't go away.
Welcome to NBC.
We baked you cake.
Thanks.
Hey, Jimmy.
Cake.
Great. Let me guess. Cake.
Cake!
Jimmy Johnson's made the move to the AFC and the NFL on NBC.
Buttons were invented around 1300 in Europe. And before that, they used string. A lot of people don't know that. And I tell my kids, oh yeah, they're just buttons, but they pay for your food, your clothes, your house, education, everything is from these. And people work here, and they support their kids, buy appliances, all from buttons. They hold a lot more than clothes together, I like to think.
It's your life's work. Does your bank understand that?
The Olympic Games, celebrating the notion that it truly is a small world. Unless, of course, you're UPS, bringing things to the games in Atlanta from every corner of that small world. Every day, we serve over 200 countries and territories, speak 43 languages, and deliver overnight to a world that still measures 25,000 miles around. Oh, we are all one big family. It's just that the family is a little spread out. UPS, Worldwide Olympic Sponsor.
Until now, the idea for every new washing machine has come out of every old washing machine. And you won't find any new ideas until you look into this amazing new GE washer. New ideas like the largest capacity tub you can buy to save up to 75 loads a year, our smoothest, quietest spin cycle, and even an enlarged opening for easy loading. Our new GE washer is the best we've ever made because it's just one good idea after another.
Keeping your business running like clockwork. We understand how important that is. That's why Chicago's hometown airline, United, gives you over 1,000 flights in and out of O'Hare, with more service to more cities than any other airline. How is it we understand business so well? Because our over 50,000 employees are business owners themselves, the employee owners of United. Come fly our friendly skies.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Olympic Stadium, where earlier Michael Johnson won the 400 gold medal, his 55th straight 400 final, and gave his gold shoes to his parents, Paul and Ruby. Now, for an update on Carl Lewis in the long jump, here's Dwight Stones.
All right, Tom, this is the man who stands on the brink of tying Al Ordered for four consecutive gold medals in a single event. This is the man who's going to try and break up that streak. Victor Saneyev won three golds and a silver in the triple jump back in the 60s, 70s, and 1980. Mike Powell has two silvers. He wants gold. He is the world record holder, but he's running out of time. Checked up at the board, but foot was over again. They used to call him Powell the Foul. Barely made the 88 team on his last jump after fouling several times. And it looks like he might be a little bit injured in the pit. He's not getting up. He just steps over about an inch and a half, and so that effort is all for naught. He's had two long fouls tonight. He keeps asking Randy Huntington, should I move it back? Should I move it back? And now he's limping. Mike Powell is now limping on that leg. 1995, he had nothing but injuries, a broken toe, tweaked vertebrae. Very frustrating for Mike Powell. The only thing he hasn't done is win the gold medal. James Beckford of Jamaica, silver medalist at the 1995 World Championships. And Mike Powell watching him. Powell is in fourth place and has one jump left. Beckford scared the world triple jump record last summer. Ooh, that's out there. Beckford's been fouling all over the place the entire night. 27-2 and a half and into second place ahead of Joe Green. And Powell stepped on the runway for his sixth and final jump. He limped all the way back to the head of the runway. This is not a face that looked like he believed that he could do it. Out of the medals at this point, U.S. having swept the last two long jumps at the Olympics. And this is not even the way that Mike Powell normally runs in to his mark. Right off the board and just keeps the sand. Powell obviously hurt. Fouls on his sixth and final jump. In fact, fouled on his last three jumps. See what happens here. He checked up. He was going to foul. And whatever injury he has, it appears as though it maybe went to his jumping leg. And he had to be helped up from the pit after several minutes. Knows that he's no better than fifth place. His Olympic dreams dashed at age 32. Quite unlikely that he will be back in Sydney 4 years from now. We have tremendous change in the long jump with Carl Lewis and Mike Powell out of the scene. He barely made the team last month and hoped that he would be here to fulfill that dream. Now Joe Green on the runway for his sixth and final jump. He's been pushed down into the bronze medal position. He's the only man left who can surpass Carl Lewis and stop him from winning four straight. And he checked up and he fouled it. That will be it. Carl Lewis has tied Al Ordered, 35 years, 28 days old. Lewis wins his fourth consecutive long jump gold. Comparisons are uncanny. and everyone trying to get one last piece for posterity. Twelve years ago, much of the world shunned him for his antics, for his arrogance. Now, 80,000 people want to embrace him. Without question, the greatest track and field athlete in the history of the sport. He's proved it all. 9 gold medals, 4 Olympic Games, longevity, world records, medals, world championships, everything. He could do no more. Carl Lewis, the gold medalist for the 4th straight time. James Beckford of Jamaica, the silver, and Joe Green, his 2nd bronze.
So can you believe it? Carl Lewis, 35 years old, wins his 9th gold medal, and he is with Chris Collinsworth.
Carl, congratulations. 4 in a row. You can't quit now.
No, I got to go. I tell you, it's too hectic. You know, to go from last night to almost not qualifying and then winning it is the biggest throw of my entire career. There's no way I can top this, and I don't see how I can ever long jump again.
You'll be happy to know that your mom actually saw this one. She kept her eyes open.
Well, that's a first. So there's a first and a last here today. But I tell you, I don't know how many people to thank. My Dr. Brown, Coach Telez, Joe, Mary Cullen, all my friends and family and the people that have involved with me for every aspect. I mean, they never gave up. Even until this morning, they kept calling me.
Carl, there's still an issue. You have 9 gold medals now. One more and you would be the all-time record holder for the Olympics with 10 gold medals. You are not on the 4x100 relay team. Should you be?
Well, I think I've proved my fitness and that I'm in good shape. I would love Chris to be on that relay team. This crowd has been unbelievable. They can't even imagine how much they've inspired me to come out here and perform. And I would love to be in that relay and run one more time and get that 10th medal in front of this crowd in Atlanta.
Will you go back and lobby for it a little bit now?
Well, I'm going to leave myself open. I don't really want to be mean and try to take anyone else's spot. But I'll look at all the options. We'll look at what's happening. We'll see how the guys are feeling, and then we'll do it. I don't want to put anyone in a situation where everyone's going to be mad at me or anyone else is creating any bickering. But I would love to run it in order to get the chance to get the 10th.
Good luck.
Thanks, Chris.
Thank you, Chris. When they were children, Carl and Carol Lewis used to play in a makeshift long jump pit their dad Bill built in their backyard. Instead of jumping, they built sandcastles, King Carl's first castle. Years later, the greatest track and field athlete of all time would use the sand of the long jump pit to build a storybook ending to his Olympic career. Ended, that is, if he is not asked to compete on the 4x100 relay. Let's hope he is. Someday, I have a feeling these fans will tell their grandchildren about tonight. Bob, I know you love baseball. Like Ted Williams in his last at-bat, Carl Lewis hit a home run.
Boy, Tom, that is an apt analogy. Wow, what a moment. For the record, and this may be a little bit of a downer, but recently Irv Hunt, the track coach for the U.S. team, was quoted as saying 5 or 6 guys would have to get hurt before we would have Carl Lewis run on Saturday in the relay. Also for the record, 9 gold medals. If that's where he stops, he ties the great distance runner from Finland, Paavo Nurmi, Larissa Latinina from the Soviet Union back in the 50s and early 60s, a gymnast, and Mark Spitz, the swimmer from the United States, who also had 9 golds. It's a night of great moments, perhaps more to come. Out to gymnastics when we come back.
Beginning, you had it in you. The courage, persistence, and determination to take the first step. Now the same strength and endurance you started with leads you here. Legs is proud to support the women of the 1996 U.S. Olympic team in this, our 25th anniversary year.
Hey, what's for dinner?
Oh, God!
Oh, honey, you should call.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't be making my famous chili.
5 alarm?
You got it.
But you know it gives you heartburn.
It's okay. I can prevent it now with Tagamin HB.
Still, dinner will be ready in half an hour.
Plenty of time.
Tagamin HB can promise to prevent heartburn in half the time of Pepcid AC. Compare the labels. And Zantac 75 doesn't even claim to prevent.
How was it?
Perfect, Ma.
Tagamet HB. Advanced prevention of heartburn in half the time. Safety features for the money. At the top of that list would be the Chevy Cavalier. So if you lived in Eau Claire and you drove a Cavalier, would that make you one of the safest people in America? Probably not, but it's a good start. Genuine Chevrolet. The cars more Americans trust.
Tomorrow night, China's Olympic platform champion Fu Ming Sha. A springboard victory gives her double gold and a place in diving history. Plus, don't miss the first ever gymnastics champions gala and the women's mountain biking debut. That's tomorrow night early, 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific on NBC.
Welcome back, John Tesh, along with Tim Daggett and Elfie Schlegel. Shannon Miller just became the first American to win an Olympic balance beam event final. We're going to have her medal ceremony a bit later on. But first, parallel bars and another chance for an American miracle. It could be performed by Jair Lynch. And another chance for Vitaly Sherba. Parallel bars, hot stuff, and they hurt. Here's a look. The parallel bars, aka the rails. They peak at 6.5 feet, while the width can be adjusted according to the size of the gymnast. The requirements, you gotta swing above the bar, below the bar, and you gotta get off the bars. The top man riding the rails tonight, Russia's Alexei Nemov. But do not count out Jair Lynch, who finished fourth in Barcelona. You think this is an easy ride? What do these faces tell you? Parallel bars. And a look at the start order. Eight gymnasts, and what is impressive for Jair Lynch is that he goes last. He gets to see everybody else. He gets to hang out and loosen up, and it is historically the best position, Tim.
It's a great position for him to be in. You know, one thing that's going on between every athlete, you see, they almost have a micrometer out there. Well, each athlete likes the bar set exactly to their specification and exact width. The Chinese bring this little stick along to help the coaches set the bars exact. They also do all this kind of junk on the bars so they get the exact grip that they're looking for. They do combinations of putting sugar and water on the bars, and it's very important for a grip skill like a giant. And Jair Lynch, as a matter of fact, does a number of those, and he has had a very bad hand.
Right, we saw in the individual all-around, actually it was in the team competition, where he was doing this, cutting a piece of skin from a...